dear Linda. According to my calendar and your honeymoon postcards, you should be approaching the doorstep of your new home about now. Steve's photos and descriptions of the house enable me to imagine pretty well your arrival. I am reconciled to the miles that separate us by the prospect of your marriage beginning in a community new to you. And beginning, I like to imagine, with the freshness of adventure. Adventure happily confined to just you two. Sentimental? Yes, Mrs. Stephen Grayson. Being an old sentimentalist from way back and a fellow whose business has inclined him to think a good deal about brides and new homes, having loved you well, my only niece, for a number of years, having been enchanted by your wedding and pleased by your Steve, I envision your beginning down there in Grantwood as if reflected in a magically romantic mirror. Knowing me, you would expect a silvery reflection. And you would be right, Linda dear. This reminds me that one of your bridesmaids, impressed by your pretty, remarkable treasure trove of sterling, asked me the wherefores of the age-long love affair between the American wife and silver. An interesting question for me. For as a designer, I have spent 35 years in devotion to the domestic career of this queen of metals without 1 hour of boredom. My feeling about it will be tangibly represented in your dining room when it's all unpacked and arranged. For some of your friends and I entered into a conspiracy to deck you out as the silver bride of the year. Knowing your taste, and admirations, I was the chief consultant. We considered and selected and appraised every piece as true connoisseurs of both Linda and Sterling. You know, a woman engaged in homemaking is a most changeable creature. Her notions about decor and colors, appointments and draperies will change with seasons, moods, and weather. That which is just right today, she will soon abandon. There's only one constant, unimprovable note, the silver note. Because you see, silver is associated with many of our finest hours, with memorable time, with, for example, your very first supper for Steve. But silver's plucking at the heartstrings goes deeper than the obvious. I am thinking of your old, old Gorham coffee service inherited from your grandmother Hudson. It has been in our family a long, long time, has brightened mornings of generations of perhaps 100 of our clan. I withheld one piece of it from you, my dear, for an inscription to make it even more personally yours and ours. For this tray speaks to me of fine craft and splendid artists of more than a century ago. It bears a message in timeless design from some man of great taste who served the Gorham Company when it was young. That's why I wanted to compose my inscription in the atmosphere from which this inheritance of yours derived so long ago. Since my first days here, I have felt that tradition in the best sense dwelt in these old designing rooms at Providence. It is a sense of this tradition, this 100-year-old continuity of purpose and high standards we hold to here, that I would like to send with this belated gift. Meanwhile,
the Library of Gorham Design will confirm David Hudson's belief in the historic, ageless dignity of art in precious metals. The line of the story is unbroken. From Babylon, 4,000 years ago, a story told in silver and gold. To Egypt, 1,000 years before Christ. to the refining, delicate, exquisite arts of Greece at her greatest. To the great rebirth of art and thought we call the Renaissance, expressed in rich profusion by Cellini, a silversmith. And on to the great upheaval in human energy that swept across the seas to make a new world, a new nation. Paul Revere, a silversmith, was there. He flashed through history, this patriot, soldier, engraver, lashing a foaming horse to Lexington. And in this shop of Jabez Gorham, Revere's younger contemporary and spiritual heir, his fiction, evidence of the marvelous good taste in which he expressed the simplicity, austerity, the freedom of the new nation rising. These notes of taste and fine craft are undated. They prevail today. Today, a century and more later, a Gorham silver vessel spins on a lathe. The lathe has evolved like all the machine age tools, but the artisanship never has wavered. The process of spinning is but a modern version of the potter's wheel of Omar. And as in ancient times, it is the hand of the spinner that counts. Now the product of this hand comes quicker to perfection than in Jabez's day. But the hand itself, as with Jabez, demands an education of years. Years ago, the first Gorham foresaw and prepared for a society that would rise on the world's highest standard of living. And today, that standard has brought into being, in his name, a great manufactory devoted to the design and processing of sterling silver. In the great plant at Providence, Rhode Island, artisanship and individual skills are still supreme, although countless engineering devices of the age have been brought to bear. It requires a minimum of 4 years to school a silver craftsman. And the man who raises this complex design with a tool that is hidden from him has grown in his special expertness over many more years. He has grown a second sight in the sensitiveness of his fingers. And in this branch of silver decoration, known as chasing, the touch must be equally fine, equally precise. For the ornamentation to stand forth as its designer planned, the surrounding metal must be made to fall to a shadowed level below it. In giving effects of perspective, of shadows and brilliant highlights, the chaser is a kind of sculptor, working with the scrupulous exactness of a jeweler. The same skill that enables the engraver to express the styles of many periods is employed to personalize these creations, to distinguish one from the other. A whole catalog of coats of arms and monograms and scripts are in his repertory. Design origins are universal. These are tiny Corinthian columns. The bowl derives through traceable steps and stages from Chinese antiquity. This simplicity we think of as strictly Puritan. And the great Dutch school of Rembrandt inspired this early American design. Pure abstraction, this salad bowl, giving illusion of motion. And so, these are materialized dreams of beauty from many ages. And if they appeal, mystically, to some not quite expressible instinct for taste and loveliness, it is because inspired artists planned them so. The artist is silver's first factor, and nowhere will you find him practicing with more imagination than in the creation of patterns for knives, forks, and spoons. The silver designer invariably derives from the practice of other arts. His three-dimensional sterling form is closest to sculpture, perhaps. But whatever his background, he is firmly founded in the classics and can find inspiration in antiquity. A hoped-for quality in silver design is agelessness. So he may reach back to Egypt, searching out some secret of the pharaohs to decorate tomorrow's table. In his major field, when he proposes to create, say, a new fork, he works with techniques that are singularly his. Whatever his source, whether it be a suggestion of some Renaissance painting discovered in a museum, or a flowering shrub growing outside his window, he must, sooner or later, work it out in three dimensions. For eventually, the piece always must be modeled in plaster, like the work of sculpture, so that volume and balance will be portrayed. For, in addition to aesthetic considerations, eye appeal, he's concerned for the fork's feel in the hand of the user. From long experience in his medium, he will determine, too, where thickness will bring a highlight and concavity a shadow on silver, the eventual material of his expression. Transference of every detail of a sketched idea into three dimensions is a cooperative procedure involving highly skilled technical assistance and a high order of criticism. For their final appraisal, an enlarged version is required. And from this, when it has been corrected, modified, and perfected, will come a bronze cast of sufficient strength to enter into the process of transmitting the original design to hard steel. The great pantograph machine and its operator, copying from the oversized bronze upon the steel of the fork's eventual dimensions, would appear to be taking over the business of handicraft. But actually, it is only doing the preliminary work on a die, a tool, a pattern tool, whose perfection will require the most exacting handicraft. It's a wonderful machine, but it cannot give the steel die the clarity, the sharpness, the fineness to register on silver. At this point, then, it is taken over by another artisan whose craft is so precise as to be comparable to the work of a specialist in optical instruments. This is the die cutter. The die cutter is in reality an artist carver, working in miniature on the hardest of metals, employing literally hundreds of stylus-like tools in portraying upon steel every nuance of the designer's intention. When you see and handle an exquisitely fashioned piece of table silver, you may remember the practitioners of this little-known but infinitely skilled and artistic craft who gave it character. In preparation for transference of the pattern shape from dies to silver, the flat sheet of silver is processed in a huge press that stamps out the approximate shape or blank of the piece. So, under a drop hammer, the steel-carved design is impressed upon the sterling with a fidelity, a permanence that will wear through centuries. Remain further handicraft stages, perfecting steps, trimming, buffing, polishing, every necessary touch to produce the final gleaming pieces as nearly perfect in finish as human minds and hands can render them. As the silver moves through these processes, you would discover from its workers that it has its personalities, distinguished and distinguishable, its characters, romantic characters, colored by history and destined for roles in dreamed of homes.
is my world of silver, Linda, where old beauties inspire and blend into new ones. And here I've had graven on your Grandma Hudson's old coffee tray my inscription, tying together two women I have loved. Maybe you will see reflected in it, as I imagine I do, the secrets of silver, the craftsmen and the artists who have loved working it. Those who have created, those who have cherished it. Like your grandmother, the first Linda, and you, Linda, in a silver continuity reaching to the years of your son. From Linda Hudson, born 1879, to Linda Grayson, born 1927. May the line run on forever in this gracious heritage.